My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
I was just bringing the wrong volume down, but we don't care because this is Cyber Chill, and we don't call it chill for nothing.
No, we are chill. What's up?
Hey, Orty.
How you been? Long time no chat.
I know, right? It's been like 10 seconds. I'm pretty good. Yeah.
Did you have a good Thanksgiving?
I had a great Thanksgiving. I really enjoyed it. Like, the kid is my favorite age. Not my favorite age, but my favorite age that he's been. He's 11. It's like he's 14, 15. He's like...
I'm getting a lot of noise.
Are you Ruby?
Is it Ruby? Is she up in your grill?
Uh-huh. She certainly
is. Yeah,
okay,
all right.
So.
Hi, Ruby!
She's doing that dog thing where they explore with their nose, you know, and snort and sniff. And she was, I realize now that you said something that she was pretty close to the mic on my computer, so.
No, it's cool. I was just making sure that it wasn't, you know, because right before we went into Foo Bar, we were having some technical difficulties. So I just wanted to, you know, but everybody loves Ruby, so.
Right. I know Ruby can make whatever noises she wants to. Me, on the other hand, and you definitely. But Ruby, she gets away with it. Murder.
No, they expect concise, hard-hitting news from you and me.
Right, yeah, the Ruby expectations are high.
And howl, and they're good.
Right. The expectations are very high when it comes to the two of us.
Right, yeah.
Extremely.
So you had a good Thanksgiving. The kid's right at the age.
Yeah, the kid is the age, right? And so he's a lot of fun. So I really did. How about you? Tell me about the Thanksgiving. Did you make breakfast casserole?
I did a frittata, which is my tradition. Mm-hmm. Instead of the breakfast casserole, I'll make a frittata, which is basically a breakfast casserole, but more of a, it's more of a skillet, but
yeah.
You cut it, you don't scramble it. So I do that to make room for all the leftovers that are kind of going to be inbound, because the turkey is usually out on the porch in a brine, so it's not taking up space, and all the other things are just ingredients that become food at that point. Mm-hmm. So I need to get the old food out of the way. So, like, you know, sausage links or bacon, eggs, some, you know, like if I've got some cilantro or parsley that's about to, you know, that's on its last legs, I'll chop that up and put it in it too. So, yeah, that's what I do. And I'll take it around in the neighborhood as a precursor breakfast. Now, Christmas, I do French toast casserole.
There you go. That's what I was thinking about. Christmas.
Yeah, Christmas is when I do the casserole. So, yeah, that's, yeah, I do my usual. I feed the neighbors. I didn't have as many neighbors around this year because without COVID, they were able to travel to their families. And so I've got some of that I didn't know. So I've got quite a bit of extra food. So.
Oh.
Froze half a honey baked and a lot of turkey, and those are, you know, the turkey is going to find itself into a turkey pot pie here probably tomorrow.
That sounds good.
Yeah.
That sounds good. So. I want Ordy to go cook for me.
Okay, well, when we get the compound up in Montana or the Dakotas, I'll be the compound chef.
Okay. All right. I mean, if that's what it takes to get you to cook for me,
well,
I'll live in the compound.
All right. Or plane ticket, whatever. We're going to figure it out.
Oh, please. I'm going to be the queen of the compound. Foo just thinks it will be her. Anyway, I really don't want to start a fight with Sam.
It's the holidays.
Not that it would. Not that we would, but I mean, you know what I mean. Anywho, yeah. So, what a week.
That, you know what? What a couple days.
Right, yeah. I want a robot car.
You want a robot car? You know what? That was that tweet you put out yesterday about the competition for the Cybertruck.
Yeah, it got a lot of attention. Yeah,
granted, it was a total concept and everything else, but I mean, I like the idea behind the concept. That got a lot of traction. Usually, you know, when we're tech nerding, you know, we'll get the usual suspects in. It's like you, me, Bo, Jeff, you know, sometimes the Gorgmons or Coder in Crisis or whatever. But this had a lot of people coming in from the outside, both interested and, you know, do not speak ill of Saint Elon. You know,
I didn't see a lot of the no ill of Saint Elon stuff, but I mean, my mentions have been crazy lately anyway, and I can't keep up and also busy, as we talked about earlier. But I think I might have missed a lot of the comments on that, but I did see quite a few people that I had never seen before. Like, I didn't know where they came from, and I just assume those people are, like, you know, gamer types from your world, but, you know, I never know.
No, No, these are just the usual right wingers who, you know, they know enough about tech. It was like what we did the on Thanksgiving, right after Thanksgiving, we were making fun of the grill that needed a software update.
Right.
Yeah, there's two things that, you know, will transcend nerddom and percolate out into the normies, and that's cars and food. So anything with tech that has to do with either of those, you will get a metric fuck ton of unsolicited opinions in our threads. But that grill one, the internet is shit. So in case you didn't see it, I brought it up and I tagged in Jeff and Lou and a couple others. It is, some dude was getting ready to cook his Thanksgiving dinner and fired up his grill, and his grill needed a software update.
But he said it was always connected. So he said it had been connected, though, since the last update in October. See, this is the problem that I had with it. The company said their last update was October. That was to any of their grills.
Which means he didn't turn it on. He's lying.
Or that was a supply chain attack, and his network is owned. So, whatever. I mean, I'm trying to tell you, dude, he was mad at me because I said he connected to... Okay, I was a smartass. Okay.
You told him to patch his shit, didn't you?
No, I didn't tell him to patch his shit. But I did imply that, you know, a hacker patched his shit and was phoning home. But, I mean, you know, it's not always a good update.
No.
The company hadn't updated since October, and he got one on Thanksgiving. But I was just being a smartass. I said, who connects their grill to the internet? He said, a lot of people. And I said, well, he called me a walnut. And I said, well, Mom may be a walnut, but I don't get supply chain updates on Thanksgiving. So I'm not that much of a walnut.
Did he actually find his way into our thread, or did you go down into his thread to go find him?
It was his grill.
Okay. So you went down into his thread. All right.
Yeah, he was mad.
All I saw on our end was all of us going, seriously, you know what you don't need to patch on Thanksgiving Day? Wood.
Yeah.
Charcoal. Propane.
Wood. Yeah. Logs.
Yeah. Logs.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was, my comment was, you know, maybe we are a little too connected.
We are definitely too connected, and what kills me is that we've been watching sci-fi movies since the 40s telling us not to get this connected. Yet, here we are.
Mm-hmm. You know, and it's like, you know, and I get it. Sometimes you buy something that you don't want connected to the internet of shit, but it just happens to be.
Well,
like, you know, my favorite story right now is a humidifier I bought. I had no idea that I could connect it to my smart home to tell it to turn on while I'm driving home from work.
You know,
or
I need
whatever.
To,
it's like, I mean,
I need to pre-record a disclaimer that says this is not meant to imply that I've never been owned, I'll never be owned, or that I'm too good to get owned. Because that's not true, as we all know. Because, we have enough conversations about it that it sounds like I think I know something that other people don't. And, you know, that a lot of what I know, I learned the hard way.
Right. Well, I mean, we did that show, was it last year or the year before, where we did our end of the year show where we told stories, you know, because... You know, you, me, and Jeff were on telling stories about where we got owned by tech.
Yeah.
You know,
that was a fun one. That was in New Year's or Christmas. We got to do that again.
Yeah, we do. That was fun.
Yeah.
But yeah, we did a show where it's, you know, it's like, look, you know, we have the name Kim Commando for people who already know how to set up their printer, but it's not that didn't get hard bought.
Right, yeah, it's all lessons are learned at the hand of some sort of pain.
Right,
some sort of pain. I mean, we're humans. We don't learn lessons easily.
Jeff posted a meme in chat, you know, on Twitter conversation, why are IT guys such dicks? And the reply was, last week I drove 2 hours to push the power button on a server that three separate people assured me had been pressed. Mm-hmm. So, and yeah, and that's, you know, it, going along with the guy who says that he patched his shit on his grill.
You can tell, so you can't always tell when someone is married to a tech guy, like if you're doing desktop support or whatever. But sometimes you can, like certain, or not a not just a tech guy, but a tech girl. Because I mean, you know, I've known guys.
There's women in STEM.
Yeah, I'm thinking of one in particular, and he was a different kind of science guy, but he was not a tech nerd. But his wife was like a real kick-ass programmer, and she was on my board. Right. So, I mean, you know, but you could tell that he was married to a kick-ass coder because he didn't have expectations of magical brilliance or
right.
Yeah, or magical capabilities or there's just a grounding there, right? Like, no, I don't want you to work a miracle. I realized that I spilled an entire Dr. Pepper on my keyboard and that that's my bad and that you probably want to kill me right now.
Nah, I'm just wasting Dr. Pepper. But,
right. No, I mean, you know, that's just an example. I'm not mad at you about this because I know right. I screwed up. That, I don't know. There just seems to be... a knowledge that some things are stupid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then the internet isn't actually magic.
I just, you know, that was a fun thread, though. I mean, just all the people who would pop in and be like, why, though? It's like, I'm thinking, why? Okay, well, why would you? And then I'm like, well, so maybe they use their smart home to fire up the grill on the way there. Nope. Specifically can't do that because, you know, they don't want you to not be present when the grill is in operation. Okay, well, maybe to have it tell your smart home to notify you when the meat is at a specific temperature. I don't know. I mean,
hey, who was that guy? It wasn't that rock guy, but he's the guy that I confuse with him that all the time. Didn't you know that guy? I thought I had seen him around. Yeah, he knew a lot about that grill, and he was smart about how he connected it or didn't to the internet. Right, which was my whole point. You don't just leave it connected to the internet willy nilly. Know when you're getting an update, even if it's not Thanksgiving.
Right.
You know.
But still, patch your grill before. You know, it's like don't patch your love sense Valentine's Day.
TVs. Right, and we talk about. We laugh or joke or whatever about, you know, the light bulbs or whatever Morty has in his house. But what you're probably going to get compromised for is something that everybody has, TVs, grills, something like that, that gets updates from the internet.
See, and it's the kind of thing that it's like, it's not that you went out to buy it. Now you can't buy it without it. Again, coming back to my humidifier.
Right.
It was one of the highest rated humidifiers, and because I live in the desert, I need it. And it just happens to have that capability. I didn't buy it because it has that capability. I bought it because it was one of the highest rated ones there is. It just happens to have that feature. But TV, I didn't buy it. Or even better example, the new soundbar I got has Amazon built into it. Well, so,
and that's the reason that the thread became such a great thread, and it was the reason that, you know, I jumped on it when you tweeted it to begin with, because people should be having conversations about this. That's why we talk about it. But yeah. I don't have anything against smart homes, smart devices, or connecting your grill to the internet. As a matter of fact, I can imagine the level of temperature control that you have when you have your temperature control in your hand, you know, to the extent that it, to the extent that it's accurate, right? It's
right.
That's a lot of control. That and that's it's very tempting to have that when you're really
well. It's also very very efficient. You know, one of the I joke about the humidifier, but one of the things is like you. Set him if, were I to use it, I would say set humidity to like 55-60% or whatever.
Right.
So that way it would shut off once it reached that level. So that way I'm not just sitting there burning water all day long while I'm at work, you know.
But if you're so, I mean, that kind of enthusiast, right, to connectivity of any kind, smart TVs and smart grills, and if you have one, you probably have multiple. There are precautions. There are things that you can do. There are smarter ways to do it. Just do it smarter, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I take precautions. I do a lot of things. I mean, we talk about threat profile. But part of your threat profile is how many connected devices that you have. It's your just that's part of your risk profile. You're at a higher risk with every device because it's just the law of averages. There's a point where there's an exploit. We've talked about this before. There's an exploit. Hackers that make money off of exploits, and there's many, many ways to do it, hundreds of ways to do it, are constantly poking the internet for those devices, those MAC addresses, and with those vulnerabilities. It might be a TV. I don't know. I don't hack, so I don't know exactly, but I have an idea.
Oh, you're pumping out very
that's because
wobbly.
And Ruby's being, like, really...
No, she's being needy.
With my computer, specifically.
Well, okay, so you're talking about, you know, mitigating your threat profile, minimizing your threat profile. You know, it's okay. I am a smart home enthusiast to the point that I understand the necessity for it, and I built it into my life. But what I've done is that it is isolated on another network that only has the other smart devices on it. It's on a separate Wi-Fi network from my computers and from everything else.
It's
so
air-gapped.
That way, what's that?
So basically, it's air gapped.
Well, it still obviously has to connect to the internet, but it's gapped in a way that, I mean, it plugs into the back of my modem to get out on the internet, but, you know, it's not on the same router, it's not on the same Wi-Fi router as the rest of my equipment, or, and even my TVs and everything are on a separate one, too.
Is it,
so
are the routers meshed together, or is it two separate routers?
Three separate routers.
Three separate routers,
not even meshed, and they all go into the back of the modem and then out into the internet.
Okay, they're hardwired to the same modem separately. They're not meshed together through Wi-Fi.
Correct.
Okay.
Right.
I mean, that's... this is my perspective again. I mean, you know, I'm such a novice at this. Everybody says that, but I mean it, right? It's true when I say it. My perspective on that is that you've narrowed that to like one single point of failure.
Mm-hmm.
So it, unless your modem is compromised, or only one router is compromised. Not that they
Correct.
Couldn't. Not that they couldn't pivot to the others, but you know, it's a layer.
Yeah, I mean, I call it a layer. I mean, they're not going to be able to get to my crypto mining computer through my Wi-Fi light bulbs.
Or they're at least going to have a harder time. You at least didn't make it easy for them, and that's what it's about.
Yeah.
At this point.
Your threat profile is never going to be zero. Just don't make it easy for them.
Right. I mean, really, seriously, at this point, I feel like it's just about not making it easy for them. And I'm not saying that it's like... I feel like hacking has become like car accidents. There are people...
It really is, isn't it?
And that just occurred to me. I've never thought of it before. This is why your podcast audience is like your muse. So yes. Anyway.
That's what you, especially when you have an engaged chat, then they can actually turn your conversation into a, yeah.
Right, exactly. And a co-host that reads the chat for you because you're, you know, already trying to do things.
You know, to take it, you know, to explain the level is that, you know, how I always talk about how your cell phone is the mom behind the Circle K. It's dirty. It's touching everything that you go out in the world with. That does not touch the same Wi-Fi network that my computers are on either. That is on the one that my TV gets its software updates from. It's not even the one that my, you know, I have my Fire Sticks on. It's, I've got one network that is specifically because Sony Bravias require an internet connection for software updates for some reason. So that is the network that my phones are on when I come home.
So that actually, I had never heard you say that before. So that was a first for me, just so you know. And LOL, by the way. And and it's also true. Your phone is the mom behind the Circle K of, or whatever, the baby mama. And not that every baby mama, or that, I didn't mean that way. Anyway, I think we should move on. Not from the conversation, but just from that part of it necessarily. But yeah, I mean, your phone does touch everything because it goes with you. Right, so you run across infinitely more public networks.
It's scanning. And we've talked about why networks, that's a problem. It's scanning. Yeah. You know, it's hopping cell tower to cell tower. We've talked about cell tower emulators. It's bouncing off open Raspberry Pi. I mean, it's touching everything. You sit there and you watch your phone, especially like when. Go turn on your phone and look for a Wi-Fi signal. Disconnect from the network that you're on. Well, I mean, after the show, do it. Disconnect from the network you're on and just watch it propagate the networks that are on in the area.
Yes.
How many of them are open and that your phone goes to touch. I mean, it has to touch it just to acknowledge, were you looking for this network? No? Okay. So
networks are as numerous as vehicles. That's why.
Yeah.
Getting hacked is like car crashes. The internet is a highway. I mean, we could do this all night, right? And it's just really common. And some people get hacked over and over again, and some people never get hacked. Some people never have a car accident, and some people have tons of them.
You want to take that analogy further, now that the internet of shit has cars connected to the internet, when you're driving past them, you are touching their Wi-Fi network, too.
Yeah, it's like the Twilight Zone. It's the Twilight Zone or a sci-fi movie or one of the million that we've seen that told us not to do this. And we did it anyway. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, like we both watched the same movie, but you got the exact opposite out of it.
No, I got it. I just, you know, there's...
created the technology. I made a conscious decision.
I've made a conscious decision that it is an acceptable risk.
Well, you're going to have to explain to me what benefit makes it acceptable.
I take care of an 86-year-old woman who leaves lights on and other things, and I set it up specifically so she could, like,
we're not talking about internet driving cars anymore.
No.
Okay. All right.
No.
Yeah.
No,
see,
no.
I mean, light bulbs.
I was talking about my smart home.
The light bulbs are, I don't think, I mean, I can think of several reasons that the light bulbs are not going to get, they're not necessarily putting your entire network, especially the way you have it set up. Right. Again, I think it's about doing it responsibly. If you're really going to be an enthusiast, learn how to do it safely, just like Gordy did. I mean, he explained his setup. All of our listeners can do that. I don't know of anybody that listens to us that can't do what you described.
Yeah, it's not only is it not difficult, it's as you said, put a lot of thought into it. If you are going to go the smart home route, and I mean, we talk a lot of shit about it, but there are conveniences and there are perks to it.
If you're going to have a smart home, you're going to put a lot of thought into it.
Yeah.
Put some of that thought into the security and look at physical firewalls. The Bitdefender has a great system to learn about it, even if you don't go with their system or, you know, there's probably reasons you wouldn't want to. I don't know. I've looked at it that close because I don't have a smart home. But look at what Bitdefender has, and you can kind of learn about that kind of thing if you wanted to look into that too. And there's actually, that's not what they're called, and I can't think of what they're called at the moment.
Well, you know, along those lines too, yeah, I keep mentioning this. Al posted a video a while ago when he was getting into the Raspberry Pis, and the guy has a great network monitor. It's kind of, it's almost like a, you know, it's got tools, it's got a toolkit in it for making an in-home VPN where you have your own private VPN and everything like that too. But it's really good for monitoring traffic, so you can see the outbound traffic of what your smart TV is telling advertisers and things like that. So it's and it really, the setup now with the chip shortage and everything, you're looking at about $100 for an inexpensive Pi that can run the software, and it's worth it. I think it's worth it.
Yeah, I think that we talked about this before, and I'm repeating what I said then. I think it's probably a good thing to repeat, though. You can get plug and play systems to protect your your home networks and your smart home system, or you can get, you know, a Raspberry Pi and just really geek out.
And yeah, what I liked about it too is that it also had a power monitor on it too. So it's like if you're Bitcoin mining, or, you know, his example was he used a to see how much power his Starlink satellite internet was drawing, because he said it's much higher than what was supposed to be being used, because he had the whole thing on solar. But like in the instance of with me with Bitcoin mining, I would put that plug in it to monitor my power usage to calculate profitability. You know, like if, you know, if the hash rate isn't, if I'm not getting a good return on investment, it just automatically would shut it down. So
yeah,
and that's in the same box. That's just a different utility that you plug into the to the Pi.
Yeah, I think that sounds fun, and it sounds like something you and Al would both like really geek out on. It sounds like a lot of fun to me.
It is.
Yes, I've been playing around with my iPad to Linux and Linux to iPad, and we talked about this last week, didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
But not on the show.
We talked a little bit on the show because I was bitching about the amount of screws that HP puts in their laptop.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Well, I mean, I'm happy to report that I'm spending about, you know, 10 times as much time learning shit. So there's that.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, it is good. Yeah, I'm happy about that. It's nice to use the brain. My brain feels better. Yeah. And we've just done like half of the show freeform. I told you I liked it.
Yeah.
I made you. I did that on purpose. I was being sneaky.
You know, there's only a couple things we need to talk about. And that's just because we teased them.
Yeah, but you teased them because they're cool.
Yeah.
But it was not. But I talked about the truck. What are they?
Well, okay, so the one thing was, first of all, with Canazon, if you're not familiar with it, it's kind of like what the internet was intended for, kind of. But one of the largest, and everybody thinks everything is evil on the dark web, and it's not. It's just not on the surface, you know. It's like, you know, when you go down behind the Circle K, it's seedy, but it's not evil. And one of the things was because not, and we were kind of joking about this before the show too, with how you living in a red state, you have to buy a different CBD product than I can just go and get over the counter. And you know, that has a different efficacy. But in this case, this is Canazon, which is a playoff of Cannabis Amazon. They have shut down their dark web marketplaces for the buying and selling of marijuana products due to a DDoS attack. And they have just decided we're not going to come back up, which tells me either they're blackmailed or – but anyway, what they completely just – they shut down and they said all transactions are going to be finalized. But they didn't announce it right away, and some people are mad about that. But that's – their excuse is actually a legitimate one in that yeah, we're sorry we had to keep you in the dark, but it was the best way to prevent vendors from doing exit scams. And that's where you kind of like, you know, you make your final transaction, then you bail out before you provide any product. So that way all the because the Bitcoin was the currency du jour on the site. So that way all transactions were getting finalized. And that way vendors couldn't just pull out and do a scam. Do an exit scam. So I like the way they did it. It looked shady at first, but I like that. I don't understand their final decision, but I respect why they did it.
Okay, so you told that story really fast, so say who you were talking about again.
Canazon. It's Cannabis Amazon. Canazon. It's a deep web marketplace for buying marijuana products.
Darknet.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a darknet. And it's okay. So there's this Twitter troll who really, really hates me. So if I let that go, there will be like 3 years from now, they'll still be talking about it. So that's the only reason I said anything. That's the only reason I said anything. It's like I don't want that to go on for 3 years. Anywho.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's. Okay, so of all the darknet markets out there, if somebody else had done it, but I mean, if it wasn't like just like at the weed shop, right? So it's the difference between the mafia ripping you off and the weed dealer ripping you off, right? So you're right. Kind of like, man.
Yes.
I mean, you know, the guy sold pot, whatever.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, am I wrong?
No, and you know it's there's another group called Canahome, and they operate with memberships and everything. And it's a way. I mean, don't think of it as a way to get around law enforcement because everything's traceable. You know, and you think you're remaining anonymous behind VPNs and Tors, but that all matters on if you know where you pop out's being monitored too. And so I'm not going to suggest people use this, but if you're in a situation where you have a need, where your need is greater than your concern about law enforcement, it might be something to look into.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Also, but you have to pay attention to is that you might get product again. This is caveat import. You might get product that may be laced with fentanyl. There's always that Anyway, it's dangerous. Obviously, it's no more dangerous than going down and buying weed for some dude on the corner because you never know what's happening with that either, unless you trust the guy. So, having said that, I mean I'm not endorsing the use of the service. I'm just saying these services exist. And this particular one was the subject of a DDoS attack and decided to shut down.
Right. Well, so there's a lot of reasons to worry about, dealing with the market like that. I would say stay away from them for any of those reasons. It not being safe. No matter
how. Yeah, but I mean, going down and buying weed behind the Circle K isn't safe either.
Right. Yeah.
So, again, right, always
assume, no, I wouldn't.
I
wouldn't tell anybody to do that either. I wouldn't say, "Hey, yeah, go over there to the Circle K because there's a guy back there. He's got some, and I know you're in pain, Grandma." I think it's awful. That there's something that's safe and harmless and helps people, and it's illegal. And I mean, it's just relatively really harmless, not addictive harmless, even. But I can't.
No, I mean, yeah. I haven't noticed any difference. I mean, aside from the obvious, kids are going to be dumb. And quite frankly, pot TikTok is the most annoying of any form of TikTok videos, even more annoying than dancing ER nurses.
I never saw that side of TikTok.
The heavy pot user, the dumb pot user chick,
the weed kids.
So, anyway,
no, I never saw the weed.
The
kids.
Weed chicks, yeah, they're annoying as fuck. They even, like I said, even more annoying than the dancing nurses. But other than that, being a California resident, where I have not noticed any change whatsoever since the gloves have come off with dispensaries. You know, it was by prescription. Now you can just walk in, and as long as you're of age and show ID upon request, just like walking into a bar.
I hear people in places that, where it's legal, talk about certain parts of certain cities. And that's it.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. Yeah, but I don't...
Jeff and Chad, my name is not your culture.
What's the name?
No, Jeff and Chad said my name isn't, you know, the stoner. Oh. My name is not your culture.
Oh yeah, I forgot. Yeah, he says that about talking about weed. Yeah. So, but yeah, I don't think that much about the legalities on. I don't think that much of. Weed as even getting buying weed as getting around law enforcement. I don't really even see it that way, right? Because I mean, let's also keep in mind that the last time I bought it was legal, and it was years ago in another state. But I'm not thinking about myself. I don't really think of it as getting around law enforcement, because I don't think they care. Really don't think they care. If you're not buying a pound of it, breaking it up and selling it, they don't care. Am I wrong?
Generally, I mean, you go back 20 years.
Yeah.
When I first moved to Nevada, California pot was a health and safety violation. Nevada was a felony 1 to 6, which is weird because every other fucking thing is legal in Nevada except for pot at the time.
Right.
So, and I got picked up for a little bit, and the cop said, well, you know, and I had just moved from California. The cop said, what would this fine be in California? I said, $50 if I didn't share it with a cop.
Oh, well.
So, and I explained to him, I knew it inside out. I was able to quote the health and safety violation to him, and they let me go with it. But it was just kind of like, still, as I was looking at a felony charge in Nevada.
But that's what I'm talking about. It was a felony charge, and they let you go with it, right? I mean, they don't.
Yeah,
you're not getting around them when they don't care.
Right.
And that was 20 years ago, and it was a felony. He could have gotten a felony. On his little whatever sheet, and he didn't even care enough about it to get it. But of course, you could have gotten a lawyer and then gone to court, and he wouldn't have shown up, and you would have gotten off anyway.
Probably.
Which is why they don't care. So anyway, that's why I don't think of it as like anything really. It's like, oh, did you buy some pot illegally? Well, shame on you. Pass me the beer.
Right.
Yeah, I just don't care. And I don't really drink beer either, so. I mean, you know how boring I am. I talk big, but I'm boring. Anywho.
You're not boring, Lou.
Oh, I'm just...
A whole bunch of people in chat would disagree with you.
Well, that's because I don't hate them. I love them. I don't hate them.
So, what do you want to do? You want to hit a break, or you just want to go straight through?
I don't want to go straight through, but we can, if you want to talk about another story, we can talk about another story. What other story do we have to talk about?
Well, we got Jack.
Let's talk about Jack. So tell me about, I still don't know anything about his replacement, which is what I want to know. Like, what's his tech background?
His tech background, he's been with the company for a long time. He joined Twitter as an engineer back in 2011, and he served as a CTO since 2017.
Okay, well, his tech background is tech.
Yeah, so his background is tech, but he's also, as we talked about, you know, Jen and I talked about in the last show, he's the one who came up with the idea of the Twitter Trust and Safety Council, which was just a whole bunch of purple-haired third wave feminists who wanted to, you know, turn Twitter into a safe space, which just actually meant that they were taking out their enemies. And it was the usual suspects of Anita Sarkeesian, Brianna Wu, Randy Harper, and Zoe Quinn, and those are the ones who started it. It's evolved since then. But if you wonder why, at one point of Twitter, this was all during Gamergate too, that, like, for instance, I lost an account because I used a GIF from Twitter's own GIF library, but it was called harassing and targeted hate against a female, against a woman.
That has happened to me.
I was defending another woman for life decisions that she had made and was condescending to the woman attacking her. And so, ergo, Latin, I was suspended. This was around that time. This was that crew that, you know, it's like, okay, so if two women are fighting, the one who has absurd feminist principles is going to remain their account and the other one is going to lose theirs. So.
Absurd feminist principles being.
I'm sorry?
Never mind. That could go in either direction because now we have two different waves of feminists fighting over competing absurd feminist ideals. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. That was not what we were talking about. But right. I was almost about to go off on a tangent. I'm sorry.
Okay. So Dorsey's going to remain on the board until next year, and then he's going to step aside. Another individual, Brett Taylor, who's been the COO of Salesforce, was named chairman of the board, succeeding Patrick Pouchet. And Dorsey had quite the long letter today. It was an email.
Did you read his fucking letter?
What's that?
Did you read his fucking letter?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Hey, you want me to read it? I got it right here.
No, I don't want you to read it, but you can certainly give me the highlights because I need to make it, like, worth your while to have read it. So.
Okay. Yeah, he said, for almost 16 years, is having a role in our company as founder and CEO and chair exec, blah, 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 blah. I've decided it's finally time to leave. There's a lot of talk about the importance of a company being founder-led, blah, 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 blah. Nobody says that. Nobody gave a shit when the colonel stepped down. Nobody gave a shit when Ronald McDonald hung out his clown shoes.
Literally nobody, yeah. Jack.
Yeah, nobody is saying that. You know, it's got, a lot of people are saying nobody. Not one. Nobody, no. You know, and
nobody, Jack.
Yeah, so he wants to know that his decision, it's his decision, and he'll own it, and, you know, and there's a lot in here that makes it, it's like, okay, so here's the people that are going to be replacing me, I'm not really giving a good reason of why I'm leaving, I'm just leaving, and I think he probably microdosed and typed this up, and then thought, you hit send, I'm like, oh my god,
totally what have I done? Did.
So, and then after the email, he said, P.S., I'm tweeting this email, which my one wish is Twitter Inc. to be the most transparent company in the world. Hi, Mom. So, anyway, yeah, he doesn't actually give a reason for leaving. He says, this is the time for me to leave, and here are three reasons. And he names three people who are going to be succeeding him as CEO and COO, but he doesn't actually give a reason. Now, my assumption is that it's because he's going to be more hands-on with Square, which is a pay terminal, kind of like an ATM, and kind of like, you know, a debit card terminal, but you can use Bitcoin cards, you know, use cryptocurrency at it. And he's also doing Blue Sky, which is a blockchain-based social media, kind of like how Minds does it, but on a microblogging like Twitter. And it's going to be more transparent, which was funny because at the Bitcoin convention last year, he got booed when he announced that because everybody knows he's full of shit when it comes to transparency. So. Anyway.
He's not all there anymore sometime.
So here's the funny thing. This was pointed out to me. When I talked about it last show, Twitter was up 6.1% from the point of his announcing he was stepping down. It's like the market, you know, that's when the market tells you that they hate you, you take that as a sign. And then when people started to investigate who was replacing him, Twitter shares went flat. And as was just tweeted to me during the last show when we were talking about it, they're now down 2.7% for the day. So the market giveth and the market take it away.
Yeah, absolutely. And she's a fickle bitch too.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, I don't, from a corporate perspective, I could give a shit about Twitter. As a matter of fact, I mean, you know, them crashing would probably be a good thing for humanity. Because, not, I mean, you
but
know,
the memes, Lou, the memes.
Yeah, that we'd get our memes somewhere. Right? I mean, there's something else.
The memes must flow.
Yeah. I mean, I think people would probably separate a little bit more, probably to some extent. But the discourse isn't real anymore. As we know.
No.
It's less real every day. Yeah, it's less real every day.
Well, okay. But here's the thing, though, is that, okay, the discourse between opposite sides is less every day. The interaction with like-minded people grows.
Okay, yeah, and it's gotten better in some ways. So now let's take a break. And you guys might hear a reset or something with the network. While we go out, but we'll be back, and rest assured. But I might play some. Oh no, we'll listen to some Elvis, and we'll be right back and talk about discourse, because you know that's always fun.
Listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans, America's largest mortgage lender. Spring will be here soon, so if buying a new home is on your to-do list, right now is the time to call Quicken Loans. Learn about which mortgage options make sense for you and get a jump on your competition. With our exclusive Rate Shield approval, the low rate you lock today is protected for up to 90 days while you shop for your new home. With a Rate Shield approval, if rates go up, your low rate stays locked. But if rates go down, you get that new, even lower rate. Either way, you win. Talk to us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com to take advantage. Here's another great reason to work with us. For a record 9 years in a row, J.D. Power has ranked Quicken Loans highest in the nation in customer satisfaction for primary mortgage origination. Again, to lock in today's low mortgage interest rate and get the security of our exclusive Rate Shield approval.
I like it. I'll take a...
Sports announcer at home?
Yeah, how do you...
We just know.
My wife picks up the new signature wrap. It's got double the rotisserie-style chicken mix with a sesame ginger glaze. She appears annoyed at me, but she shrugs it off. Those sweet and savory flavors are calling her name. She lifts the wrap and... She takes the bite! Incredible! And now she's closing the door on my... Subway, make it what you want.
Limited time only at participating restaurants. Double meat basement, average 6-inch sub.
I'm Little Teapot, short and stout.
Here is my handle and here is my spout.
No, Dad, like this. When I get all steamed up, then I shout. Tip me over and
pour me out.
This is WWE superstar Roman Reigns. It only takes a moment to make a moment. Take time to be a dad today.
Visit fatherhood.gov, brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
Are back, aren't we?
And yes, we are.
You said and. Right. So discourse on social media and in the media and in print. Well, in print is the media. Books. This is definitely happening in books and in Hollywood. And it's not real. It's not sincere. It's not based in reality at all anymore. Any of it. Right? Like, at least to some extent, reality gets lost in everything.
Yes.
Yeah, but on social media. Which is what we were talking about. Which is the that kind of it sounds cliche to call it the town square, you know, of the 21st century town square or whatever people call it. But it kind of is. It's where people talk.
Mm-hmm.
I also think to some extent because they talk about the things that they do on social media, they don't have to talk about it in other circles, and don't. I don't.
Yes.
That's true of me.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I don't discuss my sedition in real life.
Sure, if you want to put it that way.
Yeah, no, I mean, because nobody wants to hear it anyway. You know, it's like, on social media, we can all just fart out something and have our collection of friends, enjoy it and comment and we'll have a little conversation about it, and
we have a lot of inside jokes about that.
What's that?
We have a lot of inside jokes about it.
Yeah. So and that's when you try to carry that out into the real world, it doesn't translate. It's like that joke, you can't just post a random image and have the internet people get it. You can. The internet people are very smart, and they get it, and they know what you're talking about. Not only that, they know the whole backstory behind it too. It's like when somebody asks, "What do you talk about on your podcast?" I just kind of politics and tech, because if I try to explain FUBAR, if I try to explain juxtaposition, if I try to explain CyberChill, they're going to completely glaze over.
But it's like you said, it's the internet kind of in a nutshell. We talk about stupid stuff and people get it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's it.
But what's funny, what's great about it is that our peers are from like 13 to 80 and they get it. So it's not even like a cultural thing where it's like, oh, only Gen X gets it, or only, you know, it's across a whole broad spectrum of people get the meme.
It's and also an internet thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's an internet thing.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway. Yeah, but the discourse is different on the internet. And I mean, you know, there's been a million studies about it, I'd say, at this point. Not a million, but 1,000. To be. And the consensus seems to be that you're not face to face with people. So, you know, people overreact for one thing because they don't have visual cues. And you don't fear visual cues or physical reprisal. So
that's
you're
fair.
Uninhibited.
Mm-hmm. Which, I see that as a good thing, because societal norms prevent me from calling somebody a fucking retard in real life. I will call somebody a fucking retard, but I have to do it creatively, which is even better, because that's the other thing, is that in real life I would just blurt out, you're a fucking retard.
That's
where, because it's sitting there and hammering out and having to explain how somebody is obviously missing genes or has extra ones, you have to assume that that person understands genetics. Where if I just said, wow, those extra chromosomes really hurt you on that tweet, didn't it? Everybody gets it.
Right. Yeah, it doesn't matter how you say it. Pretty much everybody gets it.
Wow, we've really had to adjust the spectrum for you.
Exactly. I get that.
Yeah.
I get that. It's just an internet thing. It's not about age or class or anything. It's just the internet.
Mm-hmm.
For better or worse. And there's plenty of both.
Yeah, you know, in 2021 we'll have flying cars. 2021. Check out this cat meme.
Right. Yeah, and it's not just any cat meme. Cat memes have gotten weird.
You know, one of the best things that ever came to the internet, at least back 10 years ago, Shark Cat. The cat in the shark costume riding a Roomba.
Is that 20 years old?
Feels like it. At least 10.
It probably is. That would be 2001.
See, and yeah, Mike, maybe you're right. 15. I can explain it to you, but I can't understand it for you. And that's kind of the difference between internet people and real life people too, is that, you know, it's to explain Carlos Danger, for an example, you would have to explain everything that happened up to that point, and then, but if somebody just has the screen name of Carlos Danger, you immediately know what they're talking about.
I think internet people just get tired of the way people look at them when they try to explain.
There's that too.
I don't try. I'm just like,
I have neither the time nor the crayons to explain to you how time zones work.
And besides, it's stupid. You wouldn't laugh. You wouldn't think it was funny. It's dumb.
It's dumb. It's an internet thing.
It's dumb. You wouldn't think it was funny.
And that's how you can kind of tell somebody in real life too. When it's just dumb. It's an internet thing. Oh, tell me more. Then you know that you've met an internet person.
You know what? That's really good. I'm going to remember that. I like that, Ordy. Because you don't have to explain.
Mm-hmm.
It's nothing personal.
I'm an internet person. Tell me more.
Oh, great. I don't have to explain. Okay. Zoom. It's in the news. And Ordy drops it for a story.
Oh, Zoom?
Yeah. y'all are so mean.
You know what? Yeah. So, Zoom story. Zoom has announced today that it launched an automatic update feature designed to streamline its update process.
Does anybody feel like they've got like an? There's a new like vulnerability story or string of stories coming.
Well, and yeah, because I mean, when you look at this too, it's in the settings, and it's
they want a stealth update. Zoom wants to stealth update. I'm going.
Yeah, not only do they want a stealth update, but yeah, automatic. You know, there's a new checkbox in the Zoom settings. Automatically keep my Zoom up to date, and then you can choose slow, medium, or fast with the priorities of how often it updates your Zoom client. They've also added 2FA and E2EE. And other security enhancements to stop Zoom bombing trolls. But too late, guys.
Oh, yeah.
I still can't believe there's 300 million daily Zoom meetings.
See, but what they did, and of course I'm going to, like, diss them about what they did plenty. And I think they would do it again every chance they got. But what they did by burying those vulnerabilities and breaches and everything that was either coming or was happening, and they knew about it, they buried it until after they had a solid hold on the market.
And then not just that,
people were hooked by the time it came out.
And not only that, they had made themselves indispensable during a time when everybody was stuck at home.
Right.
You know, for telecommuting and, you know, everything else, you know, remote working and meeting with your doctor, meeting with your church, meeting with work, they injected themselves as the preeminent video conferencing software that everybody else was shit and second rate. And you, me, and Jeff at the time, we were telling everybody, use Discord, please. Use Skype. Don't use Zoom. And to the point where it even became a meme of the show. And, everybody got used to using them, then they said, oh, by the way, we've got these issues.
Right, yeah. If you want to get really tinfoil about it, I mean, you know, the timing with the Chinese company, and I mean, you know, timing was really good.
Chinese virus and the Chinese.
Yeah. Anyway, I'm not saying. I'm just saying.
Right.
But yeah, their timing was impeccable, or they were really lucky, because they boomed at the right time, and they buried that stuff just long enough. So.
Well, they couldn't hide it anymore when people were getting Zoom bombed.
And that was the beginning of the end for them. That was people really started looking closely and finding vulnerabilities, and it was going to happen anyway, but it might not have happened quite that fast.
Yeah, that's true.
It was going to happen. Because, I mean, you know, the bigger something gets, the more vulnerabilities get found. That's pretty universally true.
Mm-hmm. That is fair.
Yeah, it's fairly true.
So you came up with you found a pretty cool life hack. And while it may not be tech related, it's pretty awesome, and I think we should share it.
It is not tech related at all. So I don't, if there's a nuance to the baskets, you'll have to let me know what they are, because I don't know. I shopped it. Anyway, so Aldi is a kind of a no-frills store with no bags. So you either have to buy bags from them or bring your own bags. It's kind of a... There's some... I don't want to say that there's drama around it or anything, but bags at Aldi were always a big deal, I guess, especially when they first came around, but people came out with a life hack to get around the big deal of Aldi bags. Am I telling this right, Ordy?
Well, not just that, but I mean, it's. It's a time saving hack, because between bringing your own bags or using the ultimate, you know, and bagging your stuff, this is just throw it on the belt, take it out of your cart, throw it on the belt, scan it, put it back in your store. Now, what you do next, what happens next will shock you. This is actually a really cool idea, and it got me to research, and it's okay. One of the things is the problems with the reusable shopping bags, and it wasn't until, like with the Zoom thing, that it wasn't until everybody was using it that the real problems came out. People aren't washing their reusable bags. So you're breeding E. coli, salmonella, and every other foodborne illness possible in these reusable bags you're not washing. So coupling that with the time saving of not bagging your groceries, dude came up with use laundry baskets.
And it's brilliant. You can just like look at the pictures and be like, oh yeah, that's really smart. Cause it's just two trips from the car. That's like 15, 20 bags worth of groceries.
Right.
So that in and of itself, you've saved time and effort to make it worth it. But I'm like, you could do this at any grocery store, right? So you take
you totally can. You know, it's like, you know, because like my local is a Safeway. So it would be like, I'd take everything off the belt. You know, do you want to bag it? No, just throw it back in the cart how you found it. And then go out to my 4Runner, pop the back, and then I've got a couple of these laundry baskets, take all the groceries, put them in the laundry baskets. Now I only have to carry in two laundry baskets into the house. And Mike in chat saying his wife uses laundry baskets at Sam's Club. I actually went so far as to research to get the kind the guys talk about. I mean, not exactly the same branded, but your basic Sterlite 2-bushel laundry basket is $15 a piece. Or you can buy 6 of them for $60 on Amazon.
You can get them for less than that at Walmart.
Like, sure, like, and these things are inherently sterile, easy to clean. You Lysol them down, and you're good to go.
Yep.
You know, it's you don't have to walk like so. Awesome. I'm a huge fan of this. Now, you know, it's like I showed a couple other people. They're like, yeah, but I use the bags for trash bags and for, you know, my recycling and everything. Cool, but you can also use this. Put your bags in there, and you're making less trips. Just saying.
Yeah, it looked pretty brilliant. I thought of some of our friends on Twitter that talk about shopping at Aldi, and I have, right? When I had one really near my house in Raleigh, and I shopped there frequently. But you could do it anywhere. But it's an Aldi life hack. But you could do it anywhere.
Yeah, I mean, short of having a servant, then, you know, you might as well, you know, these little hot life hacks. Jeff made a comment, you might as well throw one of those in the throw a laundry basket in his trunk for this, or get a servant, one of the two. So, Jeeves, empty the trunk, will you?
You could do either.
Mother, you're letting him eat at the table like he's people.
You could do either. They're pretty much the same. Yeah.
Or send your servant out to get the laundry basket. Whatever.
So another Pegasus story, and this is one of we said it was going to be another one that never goes away.
Mm-hmm.
And it is not going away. So Apple, the best part of this story, or the most interesting, or whatever. Apple is suing the company that created the Pegasus malware. Okay. I think I probably lost everybody, maybe for a second. So
okay, I'm here.
Apple has sued the company that made the Pegasus NSO made the Pegasus spyware. We've talked about this quite a few times on the show. It's a malware spyware created by an intelligence firm sold to governments and other firms and God knows who. And now basically just in the wild, there's God only knows who has it.
Yeah, and it's yeah, and Apple is going so far now as also notifying targets that have had Pegasus installed on their device that they have found. You know, especially a prominent Polish prosecutor, say that five times fast, that her phone might have been infected with Pegasus, and you know they're informing several other people. Hey, this firm was able to get Pegasus on your phone. So they're being very proactive. Not only have they patched their problem, but they are so abhorrent of a NGO security contractor. Hey, let's call them what they are. Yeah, they operate with the blessing. Well, how about without the condemnation of the Israeli government? So Apple is suing them and informing people who have been targeted with it, hey, you may have Pegasus on your phone. You might want to talk to these people over here. Dial up the Israeli government. Say hi.
Yeah. So it was an Israeli firm, but a lot of the governments that they worked with were not Israel.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Let me clarify. I'm not saying that it's part of the Israeli government, but they are operating with a, you know.
Yeah, they let them operate. We let some pretty shady shit operate here too.
We definitely do.
And I'm not just defending Israel either. I'm just trying. I guess just want to be fair. I don't know.
Sure. No, that's fine.
Yeah. I think I have suspicions about that company because the hair on the back of my neck stands up every time. I think that's probably what my problem is. when someone says Israel in relation to them, I'm like, yeah, like they knew what they were doing.
Right.
Anyway. So, yeah. I don't know. What do you think?
This one keeps popping up, but it's not. I mean, I don't know if it's just because. I don't know. It keeps popping. I'm interested in the story. I'm keeping an eye on it, but it's not grabbing me the way that the Microsoft Exchange hack did, the SolarWinds hack did. This is big, and this is going to be around for a long time. But it's not. You know, it's.
You want me to tell you why? I know why. I know.
Well, lay it on me. Let me have it.
So there, with the media, the Pegasus story is the drama factor, and they're involved, right? Because it's activists and journalists. Well, Garrett, I would be willing to bet that half of those targets were personal. Just saying. That's okay. This is just based on human nature, nothing else, right? I bet that half of those were personal in some way, right? But also not legal at all and not known, right? Like the governments that they were done, whatever country, the governments didn't friggin' know that it was going on, right? It was being done under the table or whatever.
So you're saying that my contempt for the media is overriding my interest in the story?
No, I'm not. I'm saying, like, there's this big drama factor about it. They're blaming it on the government because it is the government, but...
Uh-huh.
A lot of the people that are probably to blame are not people that they would want to be to blame. But besides that, I think that there's the tech part, right? The technology and the hack itself, the story, the real story behind the SolarWinds and the Exchange hacks are way more interesting. Just the technology and the hack itself and what happened and, you know, the story, the details, mm-hmm. and not the drama.
Sure.
Yeah, it's not about the drama. It's about the tech. So that's why you're interested in that. Not because you hate the not because you hate the media, because it's tech over drama. Well, duh.
No.
You're a nerd. Of course it's tech over drama. So, yeah, that's what I think. I think that's the difference between the two stories, and the media loves the drama.
Okay. And because I'm not interested in the drama, that it's not popping up. And I mean, I'm looking at it from the tech angle going, this is kind of, you know, it's not, it, you know, when it comes to like the SolarWinds hack, the Exchange hack, it's like, this isn't that impressive of a hack.
That's my completely unsolicited analysis. Yes.
Okay. I'll buy that. Also because I hate the media.
But
no, but I mean, okay. I mean, okay.
That's just a side benefit.
I don't like the aspect that this is targeting. As annoying as activists can be in NGOs and media, I don't believe that they should be silenced or spied upon. So,
well, take what you know about the government, and what you know about the activists that annoy you. What are the chances that they were the ones being monitored?
Oh, hi. Oh, the ones that annoy me, low. But in another country, those who agree with me are probably pretty high of them being monitored.
Right. Well, right. It depends. Okay. That would depend. So, if it's not the people that you don't like that were being monitored, probably in some places. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't know. It is just another story that shows us where we've been for a really long time and just didn't know. Because
that is true.
Right, yeah. So while we look at the surveillance state and say the current state of surveillance is far beyond anything we've ever experienced before, I'm not so sure about that. It's advanced beyond where it's been before, certainly, but by comparison to our ability to monitor it or find it or be aware of it, it's less, well, it's probably less than. There was a time where, and if you think about it, it ebbs and flows. The government's ability to surveil us and our ability to ascertain that they're doing it would ebb and flow. I would say it's probably closer together now than it's been ever.
You know what's different about this time, though, is that we invite a lot of it in that, you again, talking about smart homes or smart devices or, you know, but in doing that, we also have the means of turning most of it off, you know, where it's like, I mean,
a lot of it.
Am I confident that when I turn my phone off that it's not listening? No, I'm not. I'm sure that it's still.
I think that's why we see so much frustration with, transparency or lack of transparency beyond what we used to see, and surveillance, and just a lack of truthfulness from the government. You don't see as much trust from the government either, is because they're continuously trying to limit our ability to do that.
Whenever I hear the most transparent ever, I know it's the exact opposite.
Right, yeah.
Because, yeah.
I don't really listen to what anyone tells me they are. I'll wait and see. But I certainly don't listen to what the government tells me they are.
No.
Yeah, because they will... they'll shit in your hand and tell you it's applesauce.
Applesauce.
Stop. Anywho. Yeah, so that's pretty much. I don't know, it's 11:30.
The last one is really, yeah, I'm just going to hit real quick to warn people about it. There's a Android app. Nearly 300,000 people have downloaded, and it turns out it's a banking Trojan. It was actually – it bypassed detection from the Google Play app. There's four different forms of malware that are being delivered in QR code readers, fitness monitors, and cryptocurrency apps. This goes along with before you install an app on your phone, make sure that it's aged. Make sure that it's reputable. Don't just grab the first app, because generally the first app you see, it's kind of like when you're using Google and they at least now made it more obvious that the very first ads are the very first links are ads. They didn't used to be. If you remember the old Google before, you would find yourself on, you know, bullshit sites because people were manipulating the SEOs, and it was eventually just before they'd get flagged as an ad. New apps, especially on the Google Store, don't. And we say this with everything, don't trust it. In this case, don't trust new apps unless it's coming from a source you are familiar with. Don't just get some new hot cryptocurrency app. Make sure that it's an established one like Crypto.com, Coinbase, so on. You know, I could hear Michelle fuming when I said Coinbase. But, don't just get an – I don't have to tell our listeners this. Do your research on an app before you just install it, especially with a QR code scanner, because that you are giving access to almost everything on your phone with. You're giving access to your camera. You're giving access to keystrokes. You're giving access to your contacts. You're giving access to everything. So just be more careful with those than anything else. But anyway, if you install a new app in the last little bit that's a QR scanner, a fitness app, or a cryptocurrency app, please run your scanner on it, and I hope you have Malwarebytes or some other scanner on your phone too, because your phone touches everything. It is the mom behind the Circle K. It's a dirty, dirty whore.
Yeah.
Okay. Now it's 11:30. If you're from the future.
If you're from the future. I am from the future. It doesn't look good out here.
Yes, Mike, I do. It's all part of my special Circle K app.
Is it aged?
Yeah.
What are you going to do? Where are you going to be this week, Ordy?
Thank you for asking, Lou. I am on Robinson and Hordy on Wednesday night. Thursday, I will be on The Culture Shift with Brad, where we turn our skeptical eye to the entertainment industry. And then back around next Monday with you on FUBAR and Cyber Wars. Cyber Chill. Got it. Still do that after a year. What the shit?
I don't know.
Where are you at this week?
I'm producing for Aggie and Brad tomorrow at 8:30 p.m. and back here with you on Monday. And I got a busy week, so you probably won't see me anywhere else in the near future.
Oh, I might see you a little bit on Twitters.
Yeah, maybe a little bit on the Twitters. So, but thanks for tuning in. Thanks for being in chat. It's always fun to hear what you're talking about because, you know, I can barely push buttons.
Jeff, are you going to be with us next week?
Yes. Yeah, if he's feeling...
Okay, he is, yeah. So Jeff will be on with us again next week, too.
He's feeling it. He can be on with us. He can be on with us anytime. All right, so we really appreciate it. We love y'all, like the moon and
so
the stars.
Much.
Like the moon and the stars. That's from a movie. Yeah, I'm sleepy. But y'all have a good night. We'll see you next week. And, you know.
Hail Hydra.
Wontons are just fried dumplings.
find out. Oh, as I should.